This is the Apis mellifera, otherwise known as the honeybee. This amazing little creature adds $15 billion annually in value to American food crops. In addition to this, they pollinate 80% of fruit, vegetable, and seed crops in the US. When the honeybee collects nectar from flowers, some of the flower's pollen is collected on the legs of the bee. As the bee moves from flower to flower, some of the pollen from the previous flower rubs off the bee and onto the new flower, and some of the pollen from the new flower rubs onto the bee. This is how pollination works. This cycle of pollination has lasted for millions of years. However, there's a problem. This problem has caused the loss of about 10 million beehives since 2006, and cost both commercial and hobbyist beekeepers around $2 billion. This problem is called colony collapse disorder.
We will now hear from Mr. Beckwith, a beekeeper here in North Carolina.
All right, I'm George Beckwith. I keep some hives in my backyard just for fun. My wife wanted to have bees, so we had bees. And this is one of them that I have. This is my little South Carolina hive. And it's got bees that live in the blue part down in the bottom. And then, because it's spring here in Charlotte and there's lots of trees, they brought back a lot of extra honey and they store that in the top. And probably today I'm going to start taking some of it off because there's too much of it on there. Keep this on here to restrict the size, so that if they ever decide to get attacked, which I don't think I have a problem with this one, it's a strong hive, but they can protect, they have a small door to protect. You can see him landing, one just landed and went in. He's got yellow on his legs, that's pollen that he's brought in. And they take that pollen, the rest of them are bringing in water for air conditioning, because they want to keep it the same temperature in there the whole time. So they're bringing in water and they're bringing in nectar from the trees and flowers and things like that. And these that are sitting up with their butt in the air and fanning, the ones that are away fanning, are fanning a pheromone to tell people, this is where your home is. And if I were to move this hive to where James is, they could fly 2 miles away, and they don't really see like we do. They sort of see shapes and patterns, and they would come immediately back to this spot, and if their hive was right there, they'd be confused. Some of them would die. So 2 miles away, they know that much difference. So if I have to move this, I have to move it very slowly over a period of months. In fact, that's one of the ways I can increase the strength of this hive or decrease the strength of it. If I have a weak hive, I would swap this hive with the weak hive, and all the bees that are in this one that are out foraging would come back and land in the weak hive. And they'd say, well, I don't know if this is my house or not. It doesn't smell like it. But because they had food, they would probably let them in. So, and the stronger hive would lose bees because they would all come over here, so I can keep them in balance. So you can see them walking in. That means that the fact they're bringing in pollen means that there are baby bees in there. And there's no telling what else they're bringing in. So they'll live about 2 weeks. The bees you see outside are in the last 2 weeks of their life. When they're born, they spend 2 weeks in the hive, running around with the queen, doing things like that. Housekeeping, and then they spend the next 2 weeks probably guarding and being an undertaker, taking out the dead bees, doing a few other chores, and the last 2 weeks they're flying around. Those are the ones you see, but they only live about 6 weeks. Collapse disorder. We don't have that as much here in the Carolinas, but we do have it in some areas. I have had some bees. Normally when you have colony collapse, when you open it up, you see brood, very few bees, and all the bees have just left. Unlike a swarm where half of them leave and they make another queen, they just all leave and commit communal suicide. And people believe that it's because of small amounts of pesticides that are coated on seeds that get into pollen. Here in South Charlotte, everyone has their yard done. There's pesticides everywhere. That's the biggest problem for me. My bees tend to die from getting into other people's pesticides, and bringing it back and killing each other. But because the bee has little, just like we do, parasites and bacteria that live inside it, once they get just a little bit weaker because of the small amount of pesticides or herbicides that are coated on seeds, it doesn't kill them, but it makes them a little bit weaker and it upsets the balance. So they become weaker, they can't fly as far, and they end up dying sooner, and eventually they realize it's something that they're doing that kills the hive. And the theory is that once they realize it, they get together and they all leave to save the brood that's left, the baby bees that are unborn yet, because they realize they're killing it. So it's a big problem out in Iowa, in big farm countries where they grow lots of corn that are coated in that pesticide. It's not as big a problem here, but we have other problems here as well.
The true cause of colony collapse disorder is unknown. However, as Mr. Beckwith said, recent studies have shown that one cause might be the use of neonicotinoids. Neonicotinoids are a class of insecticides that have seen increased use in farming since their introduction to the market in the 90s. 10 years after the introduction of these neonicotinoids, the first cases of colony collapse disorder started being reported. Colony collapse disorder is not just affecting the honeybee. It has also caused a decline in solitary bees like the bumblebee. The bumblebee has seen a dramatic decrease in population, with some subspecies of the bumblebee recently being placed on the endangered species list. It seems, however, that colony collapse disorder is in temporary remission. People now are more aware of the problem and it has driven them to action. For his Eagle Scout project, Franklin Caldwell is making an effort to save the bees.
I'm going to be building 8 of these habitats total, and they're going to be placed in the Fort Wilde area of the Nature Museum, where kids can go and read up on the native pollinators and how they can help them out. Some of these native pollinators that are solitary bees include carpenter bees, which you know as the bees that burrow into the wood around your house and in your house.
At this moment in time, the honeybee is in a very fragile place, and the fate of it is in our hands. We need more people like Franklin Caldwell and Mr. and Mrs. Beckwith, or else we'll starve. For without pollinators, there is no food. So take action, get educated, and do your part to help save the honeybee.